PAC for Renewable Certification, DNVGL, India. Mr. Ramesh Kymal, he is the Managing Director, Siemens Gamesa Renewable Limited. Mr. Sunil Jain. Mr. Sunil Jain is the Chief Executive Officer and Executive Director at Hero Future Energies Limited, India. And Mr. Vipul Tuli. Mr. Vipul Tuli is the Managing Director at Sembcorp Energy India Limited. On the dais, we also have with us Mr. Bhanu Pradap Yadav. He is the Joint Secretary, MNRE, Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. I will request Mr. Sumant Sinha to kindly take the proceedings off.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all for having come for this session. I must say that we have a real galaxy of stars here sitting with us, and a pretty full galaxy in that we have quite a few people. But what that will do is it will actually give us a very comprehensive overview of the sector from different points of view, from the point of view of manufacturers, IPPs, investors, technology providers, service providers, and of course the government as well. So I think we'll get a very broad view of what's happening in the sector. What we'll do is, in terms of running the session, is that we'll do a quick 5-minute intro by each of the respective people here, who'll talk about a specific area that we've discussed prior to this meeting, to make sure that we cover all the bases. And then after that, we'll have a question and answer session. So we'll open it, of course, to the House. So please start thinking of what questions you might like to ask our panel. And of course, also at that point, let us know who you are directing the question to. So the session, as you know, is on onshore wind. And the topic really is to talk about the opportunities and risks, and also about what are the latest developments that are happening in the sector. Now, as all of you know, the wind industry has gone through some fairly interesting times over the last few years. We started off many years ago with the feed-in tariff regime. That feed-in tariff regime, over the course of the last couple of years, has changed into now a competitive auction method of allocating capacity. And since the beginning of last year, in January, we had the first auction, January 2017. And since then, we've had now 5 SECI auctions and 1 NTPC auction. And of course, we've had some auctions at the state level as well. And so that's really where we are. I think since the auctions have started, we've allocated, we've auctioned about 7,500 megawatts. We'd love to hear from Mr. Yadav as to what the plans are going forward. And hopefully he can give us some, shed some light on that. And we all know, of course, that tariffs have come down quite substantially. And that has been happening because of some significant improvements on the technology side, as well as the ability of connecting into the ISTS network, which has allowed us to get into better wind zone sites. So I think it'll be interesting to hear from the panel as to what they think is likely to happen on those counts into the future, and how that might impact the wind industry going forward. So without any further ado, I'm wondering whether I should start from this end or from that end. But Mr. Yadav, why don't we start with you, because it'll be great to hear from your point of view what the government's plans are, what the government's aspirations are from the sector, and then we can all give our views after that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. In fact, I can say in my very brief journey of in charge of the wind sector at the national level, policy perspective at the national level, I witnessed this transition. I mean, some call it transition, a lot of other call it earthquake, but I'll call it more that the it has brought in a lot of competition, and the wind power has become affordable. Further, I look at more at the challenges which I at the national level am facing. One is regular coming out with the bids, you know, on a regular interval. The projections are, like say, if we treat that 60 gigawatt as sacrosanct and try to do more than what is there on an year-to-year basis, we need to do let's say bidding now, let's say if we treat that FIT is not available, of about 8 to 10 gigawatt per year. And unfortunately, that change has also brought in that the state level bids have almost stopped or has reduced. So most of the bidding has come to the central agencies, which is either SECI or NTPC. So that's one challenge to keep the boat continuously moving. The second challenge are more that how do we reduce the now we often face the critique of variability of wind power. I mean the variability of renewable power from our sister ministry of power, and how do we reduce the variability? Now this can be a wind if we compare between solar, wind is better placed, but at about 30 plus percent PLF. But how do we take it further? So there are a couple of things which we are working on. It one is offshore, which takes it to about 45 to 50%, which we had the session just before this. Second is hybrid. So hybrid, bringing out the hybrid, there are a few projects are already there, but we are trying to come out with the first hybrid bid, and that is on. Another challenge which to some extent has derailed our journey is the connectivity. You know, as you are aware, that the cycles, the time cycles of renewable energy project, whether it is wind or solar, is far lesser than the time cycle of a evacuation project, which is about 3 years or so. There will always be some mismatch between the infrastructure, evacuation infrastructure, and the renewable infrastructure. So that's the challenge which we are facing at the ministry's level, and we are having regular meetings. And so I believe to some extent those perceptions that this is the major bottleneck has gone, but yes, the coordination issues remain. Another thing which we are trying to do is not in a regulatory way, is the wind has been a traditional industry for running for more than 20 years, and a significant component of value addition is taking place in India. But this is varying from, let's say, almost 10 to 20% to about 90-95%. So we are trying to see that how do we enhance the component, you know, which are being made in India. What are the policy gaps, or what are the other regulatory gaps which are forcing the OEMs to import, and can we mitigate those challenges? So with these challenges, I believe that we are on, by and large, we are on track, and we hope that we will be able to meet those targets. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yadav. We'll have a lot of questions for you, I'm sure, at the end, but let us just move on. You know, I'm just going to jump around a little bit and not go in the specific order that we were in. So let me, and that will keep you all of you a little bit on your toes as well. So let me just jump now to Sunil Jain. Sunil, as an IPP who's operating in the wind sector and has been, and you personally have been in the wind sector probably the longest amongst all of us, with the possible exception of Ramesh here, how would you compare the wind versus solar dynamic? Just to put that right up front and center in the beginning of the conversation itself.
Well, I would put, you asking me to choose between Rekha and Ashwara Rai. Both are beautiful. Well, having said that, both are unique in themselves. Wind has been here in India for a very long time, and it's a far more mature sector than what we have for solar. I'm not saying solar is not mature, it's catching on very fast. But if you were to actually compare the two, even though I'm a president of the Wind IPP Association, I've been in the wind sector for a very long time, there is a possibility that solar may outbid wind in the long run. And why I say so, there are a couple of reasons for it. But as of today, I think so both are on the equal footing. So what do we compare between wind and solar? From an investor's point of view, like whether it is Sumant or Hero or any of the IPPs, for them, I think so wind and solar are same as long as our returns are same. We are agnostic to that oh, I will do only wind or I will do only solar. Yes, there are companies who are exclusively in wind and exclusively in solar, but they have different technological reasons for that, or their investors have thought about it. But people who are in both the sectors, it doesn't matter to them. But I have a couple of points, you know. There are a few challenges which I say for wind is because wind gestation period is higher compared to solar. Ease of operation in solar is better because wind, with all its operation, rotating parts, moving parts, it needs a lot of specialized operations. So that helps companies in ease of operation because you can do your own OM, whereas in wind you can't do that. But I believe the differentiation will going to be the technology. Today, wind technology is moving faster than the solar technology. Solar, the pricing is moving down not purely because of technology. Let's be very honest about it. In wind, the price is moving down because of technology. You've got higher swept areas, you've got higher hub heights, you've got new type of generators, so on and so forth, and therefore you're capturing more energy per swept area. Which may not be so much true for solar. Solar efficiencies have remained 17-18% for last 3 years. They are about that, they'll go up to 19-20. Till such time some path breaking and disruptive technology comes into play. Solar pricing is going down more because of demand supply rather than anything else. So I would put wind way ahead in terms of technology above the pedestal. But unfortunately, technology alone will not feed you. So the returns will. So that's where the wind has to compete with solar. In India, tariffs for wind and solar are almost at par. And that's one thing which is very positive. The wind has been really competing hard with solar and giving it run for the money. And we have done it without compromising the returns. So that's one very, very important point. Otherwise, in the pre-meeting discussion, Steve was saying that the solar prices are higher in many parts of the world compared to wind. Well, in India, it was the other way around, but we have done well. And for that, the congratulations should go to entire wind industry, which I would say is manufacturers and the IPPs. Everybody has worked hard for that. Now, another part is land. Again, I think a footprint of a land to install a wind turbine compared to solar, where you need a large contiguous land. Now, as you move forward and you do 100 gigawatts, the contiguous land parcels will start becoming smaller and smaller. Unless you cover the Rajasthan desert, that's a different matter. So, again, wind will score on solar in that front. So, I am, to be honest, not so much worried about the wind versus solar. Both are on the equal footing as far as India is concerned. But outside, I would leave it to Steve and others to comment as to what is going to happen in wind and solar. But one more thing is there. Mr. Yadav talked about PLFs. I think so wind far outweighs solar in PLFs and will continue to do that for at least a decade or maybe 2 decades. That's something which is going to be the path-breaking thing for wind. And higher the PLF, the better optimum utilization of the equipment is important. So as of today, from investment perspective, it is all equal. But from technological perspective, I think so wind is a notch ahead of solar. Thank you.
Thank you, Sunil. So it started off as tough love, but fortunately you balance things out at the end. Let's move on to Ramesh. If you can give us a sense of how you think this technology play that Sunil alluded to is going to work out as we look now forward. We know that there have been some tremendous improvements on the technology side, frankly, that have surprised a lot of us in the industry, and full marks to all the wind OEMs for having done that. But looking forward now, do you think that we are sort of plateauing off, or do you think there is a lot more juice where this came from?
Yeah, Mr. Sunil, what he said is absolutely right. Wind, the technological improvements have been tremendous. It's not only now it has been accelerated. It's been there from day one, when, you know, we had plant load factors at 12 to 17% on class 2 sites. And now with class 4 sites, we are getting more than 40% PLF. There's been a huge technological improvement. But this transition from feed-in tariff to auctions was a kind of a, you know, an alarm or a kind of a notice to the wind industry that they have to speed up even more. So what we used to take as 4 years cycle time to introduce a new model, now we are doing it in about 2 years' time. That is taller towers, larger rotor diameters, and nominal power which is suited for our Indian grid conditions. That is why we have been able to achieve this high PLF. And talking of the costs, actually, yeah, we have managed to reduce the tariff. Managed to reduce the tariff by improving the efficiency. However, even though he said that, you know, the margins of the IPPs have not been affected, the margins of the manufacturers have been affected very badly in trying to keep to that tariff. So much so that, you know, many of the manufacturers, most of us are actually bleeding. So this cannot be sustained in the long term. So we have to be realistic about it. Tariffs will go up. Also in solar, it will go up. But solar, you must remember that wind is actually make in India. We make 100% in India. And solar is actually more or less 80% imported from China or from other countries. And we are completely at their mercy on that, from exchange point of view, from the energy security point of view, and so it's not a good idea to keep on importing. So when you're comparing tariffs, we should have a level playing field when we compare that tariff. That is not there right now. However, the consumer will not pay a higher tariff just because it's made in India. So what do we do to make it more and more competitive in India? Look at 2 years ago when we did more than 5,500 megawatts in India for the first time. We keep saying that we have the potential to make 10,000 megawatts in India. But is that a reality? The risk is that the component manufacturers have not been able to keep up to even 5,000 megawatts. When it came to 5,000 megawatts, I was importing almost 60% from outside the country because our suppliers could not keep up the thing. So when it goes to 10,000 megawatts, what's going to happen? The solution is, if we have to make the component manufacturers start investing in their manufacturing, we have to have a long-term policy for volume. We must say that this is the volume that we can give. The good beginning was, of course, the 175 gigawatt. But what follows is something which we have to really look at very, very carefully, because we have been having stops and starts, and people who want to invest are now holding back unless they get a very clear signal from the government that this is for real. So that is the message that I would like to give you, that volume should come back. There has to be predictability of long-term policy, and then manufacturing will come. And let me tell you, we, Siemens Gamesa, we have 43 plants all over the world. In India, we make our products the cheapest in anywhere in the world, cheaper than China. So we have a great potential to export. We are already exporting blades, but we need some incentive for exporting it. Just duty drawback may not be enough, because the freight charges from India to US, for example, is about as the targets are met, and the energy security angle is also taken care of. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ramesh. So what you're basically saying is that it's not just improvement in technology, it's also improvements in the entire supply chain from a component standpoint that will also have a big impact on taking cost out of the equation. And therefore, volumes are important in that respect. Now, talking about volumes, Malcolm, let me come to you. If you got Mr. Yadav alone in a room and you were able to tell him these are the improvements that I require from a regulatory standpoint, what would those be as a foreign investor?
Wow, that's a very specific question. Thank you, Sumant. We should start with a positive, actually. And the structure for auctioning wind and solar capacity that the government has put together here is very good. It means that it's transparent and pretty much, with the exception of a few cancellations that have happened, which I don't like the look of, I have to say. It means pretty much if you win an auction, you take part, if you win the auction, a project will follow. And that's a very good, certain path to a project that serves the industry well. And I think coupled with that, the ambition that the government has shown here is laudable. It's certainly a world leader in ambition, which is excellent. It's showing the way for an awful lot of the world to be able to focus on renewable energy and displace carbon emissions. That's all very good. But the key risk for us when, as a foreign investor coming here to India, the key risk that we see is regulatory change. And you touched yourself on the switch last year from feed-in tariff to auctions in the wind space was extremely abrupt. It was very, in my view, it was poorly managed, and it led to a great deal of distress around the industry. Developers like ourselves had spent money developing projects which suddenly were useless. Manufacturers were left with empty factories and having to lay people off. And that's the kind of regulatory change that we really must avoid. The government needs to work very hard to signal changes in advance, to take consultation and make sure change doesn't damage the industry, so that the industry can smoothly help the government meet its targets. And there's one other piece of regulation that exists here in India, which I'd like to highlight. And this, for those who are familiar with the English vernacular, this is my hobby horse. It's my favorite subject to talk about. And that is the cross-subsidy that exists in electricity tariffs to the end user. The rural poor and others are receiving it below cost, which encourages irrational consumption. And the industrial and commercial sector are paying over the odds in order to cross-subsidize those people. That suppresses business activity. It suppresses the economy. The government really needs to do something about that. I know it's very difficult. There are hundreds of millions of votes in that cross-subsidy. But the government needs to grab the bull by the horns and fix it. And it's possible. It's being done, I believe it's in Iran, where the government put together a scheme which paid each family who was on the receiving end of the cross-subsidy a monthly lump sum in equivalent into a bank account, and at the same time they transitioned to a cost-reflective tariff. It's really possible. The government could do it, and they should do it. So that's the key risk for us, regulatory.
Okay, thank you. Let me switch to another large foreign investor, which is CLP. Derek, you all have been in India for quite a few years. You expanded quite rapidly in the beginning, and then for a bit of time there was a pause. Now you've just done a transaction. How are you looking at the Indian opportunity right now from a future growth standpoint for CLP? And what would you suggest again to Mr. Yadav would be the things that you'd expect to see from the government that would allow you to invest much larger amounts of money into the country?
Thank you. As you say, CLP are one of the largest investor-owned companies in the APAC region. And we operate here in India, in China, in Southeast Asia, as well as Australia and our home market in Hong Kong. We've got about 27 gigawatts or 27,000 megawatts, of which about 3,500 megawatts is renewable. That's wind, solar, and hydro. Here in India, we have around about a gigawatt of wind and a few hundred megawatts of solar. And we're looking to significantly increase that amount of renewable into our portfolio. And the things that we look for are in line with what's already been mentioned. We look at the regulatory change regime, how often that occurs, the nature of that. We look at the political support that there is for a particular technology. We look at the market in which we're operating in and how it rewards efficiency, competitiveness, and we look at also the local factors. If we look at our current portfolio, the operations of them, we can see curtailment ranging from less than 3% up to more than 30%. That's a lot of energy that's wasted, and a lot of revenue that's never to be seen again. So these are the kind of risks that we look at when we're operating in a country like India, and we face the same challenge in China. On the plus side, clearly there's a huge impetus, there's a huge appetite to grow renewable here in India, so we see that as a huge positive, and we see ourselves very well placed because we operate all of the technology and we've been successful at developing and operating and maintaining projects going forward. So we see ourselves as being well placed, and we're keen to capitalize on the growth of this particular market. I think the other opportunities that we see above and beyond those that have already been mentioned, we can see opportunities in things like not just the technology, but also opportunities in repowering. If you look at some of the early sites that we're using early and small technology, and with an existing grid connection and a proven wind resource, because quite often the earlier sites were of a better wind resource, then it makes perfect sense with modern technology and the advances that have been made to repower some of that technology. And you could see multiples of gains in a very short period of time without the challenges that we've often faced, and that is acquisition of land. Even when the land has been acquired to us, and it, as a request to the government, this would be one of them, that even when we've been handed land that has been acquired and allowed us to build, it hasn't removed many of the local issues that we've seen around security and around access to our sites. So that would be a request to government if that could be, it could be helped in any way.
Thank you. So just to summarize, curtailment risk, land acquisition issues from you, Malcolm, changes on the regulatory side. Mr. Chalsani, if you were talking to a new investor and you wanted to get them to come in and invest in India, which I'm sure that you do, given some of these risks, how would you talk to them? What would you tell them to entice them to come into the country?
I think
what other opportunities are there beyond the vanilla, you know, utility scale installs?
I think, Sumant, in my experience, in the wind of the renewable sector must be the least compared to anybody sitting in the stairs. But I spent about 4 decades in the sector, in power sector, so more my talking would be from the point of sector. Obviously, the renewable is becoming the main part of the power sector today, and the opportunity gives. We are at 70 gigawatts when we talk about renewable power, and 20% of the capacity being coming from renewables. Though by generation, we're just about 8%. But with our target of going to 21% by 2021-22, what becomes more important is that the how do we sustain this growth? That's what is most important for any investor to come in, is that is this growth sustainable or do you hit a roadblock? My experience is that in this country, the demand for power depends upon two factors. One is the tariff, and the second one is when is it available? Is it available when I need the power?
Can you just hold the mic a little bit?
Yeah. Second point is that when is the power available? Is it available when I need the power? So point one on the tariff, I think the renewables, we achieved the target. That today it is the cheapest source of power compared to even the conventional power, except maybe the large period power stations. Now what is important for us to achieve is that this power is available on demand, around the clock type of thing. If we achieve that, then it becomes sustainable. The investments, more and more investments will come in, especially when you're talking about 20%, 25% by generation, by energy in terms of that. That's where I think, in my opinion, is that the next set of activity all of us have to do, all the three players, one is whether the OEM and IPPs together, or the utilities, and the third is the government. On the IPP and the OEM side, the technology which is coming in actually flattens the generation curve more and more, but more important is that grid interface with respect to LVRT or HVRT, these things, and other one is frequency control. Third is most accurate forecasting and scheduling, which is very important for us to know, otherwise it's not possible for us to integrate to that extent with the grid. On the utility side, which is we're not done till now, which we need to do is that till now the generation actually chases the demand. So we need to do a reverse, and the demand has to start chasing generation. So the demand has to shift by TOD metering and various things to when the generation is available, to flatten it to some extent the curve. The third point which is the government needs to do in terms of making it sustainable is that how do we make the renewables into round-the-clock power? We started working on the hybrid, move much faster on this, where the storage as and when becomes viable. But I think there are other areas to make it much more round-the-clock power is that, which some people are talking about, is that can we club renewables with pumped storage? Can we club renewables with open cycle gas-based projects? Because when you talk about the tariff, we normally talk about tariff in isolation of availability of power at what point of time. Because the value of the tariff important is at what point of time the power is available. So therefore the tariff is different for that. We generally just talk about PPA tariff on this. So even if the tariff slightly goes up, but if it is available at the time when it's required, then it becomes sustainable. I think the next set of work what we need to do, because we achieved whatever we spoke here, we achieved that technology, we achieved the power tariffs being lower on this. I think the step two is how do we make it as sustainable round-the-clock power so that you are actually replacing the conventional power because which is available on the demand. I think that's the second set of things which all of us need to talk, and that is what will make every investor to come in. Otherwise, we will at some point of time hit a roadblock for this.
Thank you. So, just to sum up, what you're saying is that we're at 8-9% right now of renewables. We can go up to about 15-17%, maybe 20%, but then at some point we'll hit the roadblock, and so we need to work on finding solutions across the industry for addressing that particular problem. Just to shift tack a little bit, one other thing that is required, obviously, for large-scale rollout of renewables, and of course in this case wind, is capital, because that's obviously one of the most important raw materials for getting any project off the ground. And the question really is, do we have a proper environment where large amounts of new capital can come in? And just given the fact that our target is 175 gigawatts and we're currently at about 75, we need another 100 gigawatts to be added, which is roughly about $100 billion of new investment. Now, where will this capital come from? Is this capital looking to get into India at this point in time? Let's shift our discussion a little bit to that, and let me bring in Vipul. Vipul, if you can talk a little bit about what has been your experience on the capital raising side with both strategic as well as financial investors, and how you think they might be looking at India at this point in time, and what could be done to really redirect much larger amounts of capital into the country.
Sure. Thanks, Suman. I think before I get directly into answering your question, I just want to make one observation that I think the wind industry as an industry, either we give ourselves insufficient credit or we get insufficient credit for what this wind industry in India has actually achieved so far. And if you actually think, different people have alluded to it in different ways, but I just wanted to underline this point that if you look at the new technology for onshore wind that has been developed for India in terms of low wind speeds, if you look at the tailoring of that technology, if you look at the scale of projects that we are now doing in India onshore, the speed at which these projects are being done, if you look at the costs at which these are being done in an Indian cost of capital environment, and with enormous indigenization that some of you talked about, you take all this together and think about the transparency that has come, you think about the capabilities that have been built in India. This is truly one of the sectors that we can and should be proud of as a country. So I think that's just one background to the discussions, because very often with any infrastructure, long-term sector, wherever there's a regulatory change or other things, we tend to get a little correctly sort of focused on the near-term issues. But this is truly something remarkable that this sector has pulled off. Now, coming to your question, I think having spoken to a large number of investors, and we are fortunate to be to have a very strong global parent, there's probably three things that most investors or capital is looking for. One is how to make returns more reasonable, to actually earn something over cost of capital, how to make returns more predictable, and how to make returns more sustainable. Reasonable, predictable, sustainable. And let me just spend a minute on each of these. First, to my mind, around reasonability of returns, it basically comes down to the question of how we as an industry are going to think about financial viability for these long-term 20, 30-year projects versus simply focusing on tariff reduction. And I do think this is a question, it's not a policymaker's question to address, it's not an industry question to address, it's, I think, collectively this question does deserve our attention. From an IPP perspective, I can tell you that there are real concerns about whether we are building up too much systemic risk in the industry. In terms of long-term interest rates, we are doing fixed tariff PPAs for 25 years with floating interest rates and with floating with variable wind that goes into it. So how do we actually think about matching our assets with our liabilities, both in terms of tenures and in terms of the kind of risk that we are taking on? Are our returns that are being earned? Sunil talked about returns in wind and solar. I think how do we make sure our returns are actually commensurate with the kind of risks that are being taken? Several of the speakers talked about regulatory risk. So whether you talk about payment delays, you talk about regulatory changes, etc., and compare those with the kind of cost of capital and the kind of risks that are being put in. And you think about long-term capital that wants to stay in the projects for 20, 30 years versus just exit after 3 or 5 years. Are those risks really commensurate with that long-term capital? I think it's a real question we should be thinking about. In particular, with the new RBI norms, with the new IBC norms in the country that are hitting the thermal sector, that are hitting other infrastructure and other sectors, we really need to make sure that for reasonable long-term returns, are we really thinking about resilient companies that are being built for the long term? That's point number one. Point number two, if you think about predictability of returns, the IPPs alone or the OEMs alone can't really pull this off. There has to be, in my view, if I could, for want of a better word, we do need to think about better interlocking of the system, whether it's with the policy regime in terms of how much and what the nature of the pipeline is. I think one of the speakers, I think it was you, Ramesh, who talked about sort of stop-start in the pipeline. I mean, how do we keep that pipeline going? Because whether it's investors and IPPs or it's investors and OEMs, people want predictability. But equally, transmission capacity. And at least some of the work we've been doing suggests that, Mr. Yadav, you talked about that mismatch between the transmission timelines and project timelines. I think it's quite an interesting exercise if you break that up and say, for argument's sake, you look at 12 months versus 18 months. If you take the 18 months or 24 months for a transmission capacity addition and actually break that down into what is consuming that period, I think we'll find that at least 30 to 40% of that period is actually ordering time, equipment manufacturing time, which if we think about this very differently in terms of closer interlocks between the IPPs, the bidders, the manufacturers, and the transmission provider, a lot of that can be standardized and taken out of the system. So if you're able to, for instance, knock off 6 to 12 months in the ordering and manufacturing system through pre-orders, through standardization, frankly, there should be no reason for that mismatch. So the second thing in terms of predictability is really how do we get better interlock between the companies, the policymakers, and the various supporting infrastructure around us. And at least my sense is that it's eminently achievable. It's eminently achievable. Third and final point is really around long-term sustainability. And I want to pick up on JP's point about what happens when we go from, say, 8 to 10% from renewables to maybe 20% on renewables. For long-term sustainability, I think most countries have found, and we have several international speakers here, maybe they can talk a little bit more about it. Most countries have found that up to about 8 to 10% renewables, a country of the size of India with a fabulous copper plate grid at the national level is able to more or less seamlessly absorb 8 to 10%. But the moment you start to get to 15 to 20%, it's no longer possible to seamlessly absorb that. And then the kind of integrated planning, and that's the word I really want to emphasize, the integrated planning that is then required is of a very different order of magnitude. Whether this is integrated planning between thermal and renewable, between wind and solar, between renewables generation and storage, between the central bidding and the state offtake, and we've seen many examples recently where the center has run ahead of the states or the states have run ahead of the center, so that interlocking, and or indeed, you know, whether it is actually integration at the short-term forecasting and short-term sort of planning level. So I just think these that the kind of integrated energy planning that we are doing at the moment really needs to get down, not from the strategic level, I'm really talking about the operational project by project kind of level, is something that I do feel in a longer term sense concerns providers of capital. So to sum up, I think the three aspects are really the reasonability of returns, the predictability of returns, and the long-term sustainability of those returns, both for IPPs as well as for the OEMs. And frankly, in a context of, let's not forget what we've done. We've created a fabulously high-achieving industry. Let's try to keep this going.
Thank you. Thank you, Vipul. Just moving on now to Daniel. What is happening on the technology front? Because I know you do a lot of work on the technology side, obviously outside both the utility level as well as at the smaller turbine level. What's happening? What are the new developments that are happening? What are the new things that we can look forward to?
Okay. Hello? Okay, great. Just want to say how I enjoy coming back to India. I meet a lot of intelligent people who have a sincere interest in learning new things. I enjoy it very much. I'm here as part of a Israeli energy delegation, and I'll be doing matchmaking for the next week. And after I finish, if anybody is interested in, I'm looking for partners in manufacturing projects, et cetera. After I'm done, please let me know. I'd like to talk about innovation. Innovation has a particular tie-in with cost, because as costs are dropping, things are becoming commoditized to some extent. So one of the ways, in addition to general efficiency and finance and all the other things that everyone's talked about, that we have to advance is to make technologies that are more cost-effective. So I'd like to first talk about some other ones before I talk about some of the things I'm working on. So one major area is digitalization. The world is becoming digitalized. And that means that you can take the huge amounts of data that are being created by wind farms and use this to find small differences in terms of how you adjust the turbines. And this is one thing that General Electric is maybe leading the group in. They have already been collecting big data in order to assess how the turbines work together in a wind farm. Another way this is being done is Vestas sometimes helps their customers decide how to place their turbines within a wind farm is where they'll get the best wind exposure and other things. As we're progressing, turbines are getting bigger and blades are getting bigger. So there's a big need for innovation in terms of materials, because the blades are getting so long that you have trouble with fatigue and all sorts of other things. So there's some interesting solutions coming along. I know of several companies that are actually starting to make drones and robots to inspect blades to make sure that they get taken care of in time or they don't crack. And there's some other interesting possibilities that involve different kinds of sensors within the blades as well. Another aspect of digitalization is integration. Some of the people here have talked about wind versus solar. I'd like to talk about wind plus solar, because you really need to integrate them both. And if you have wind, solar, and storage, how do you determine? How do you determine in advance how much you're going to need in terms of your storage, which is just the cost, really? It's a cost that doesn't produce anything. It helps you conserve what you've produced so that you can minimize the amount of storage, or that you can integrate in different locations, for example, monsoon season, not monsoon season. What is the best mix? So there's a whole lot of digitalization, coordination, integration to go with that. I'd like to talk about my field a little bit, which is aerodynamics. I've done a number of disruptive things in terms of applying computational fluid dynamics to problems in large, medium, and small wind. With large wind, we have a way of increasing the power output of large wind turbines by about 40% by doing something that's very different. It's changing the wind. In other words, using computer models to change the wind that enters the turbine. So that when we did our prototyping in Israel, for example, side by side, one of them, the test turbine, produced 156% more power than the one next to it, because we made structures that changed the way the wind hit the turbine. This is also important for India, because it shifted the power curve down by 1.2 meters per second, which opens up whole new areas for wind energy that didn't exist before that can be addressed profitably. Another area I'm working on is small wind turbines. And we live in a very crowded world, and the only way that you can get small wind turbines into our crowded, rooftop, urbanized world is drag vertical axis, because they don't have much noise or vibration. So what I've done is I've done a number of things that have made that type of turbine much more efficient than it was before, including, I'd say, the main one is that we've created a cluster effect whereby when you put them close together, at the right distance, the power jumps up because they feed wind tunnels into each other. So that's really a game changer that I'm looking to bring to India. So these are some of the things you can do with the whole field of aerodynamics as well. So that there are many different areas where there's innovation happening. And there's even innovation or need for innovation in areas you might think are commoditized. I was listening to a webinar this past week from the American Wind Energy Association on cables. You wouldn't believe how many people believe that the cables that they're buying have been correctly tested. Well, when you saw some of the pictures on the webinar, you'd be amazed at how poorly some of them perform. So you can do all these great things with higher towers and new aerodynamics and more digitalized production, but if you're not getting the transmission through your cables, you've lost it all. So there's so many things that we can do and many new and interesting things coming along in terms of what can we do to make winds even much more cost effective and better than it is now.
Thank you, thank you. And I'm sure a lot of those innovations will be required as we go forward, especially if we have to compete against other sources of energy. Thank you. Per, so tell us a little bit about what you guys do at DNV and what are the specific things that you see happening in India that are not happening in other geographies that you think are unique to the market here or that we could be doing and that we're not doing that other geographies are doing at this point in time. Are there any such things that you think are obvious that come to your mind readily?
Well, thank you for inviting and thank you for the questions. First of all, I think I would also like to say that it's actually quite an achievement in India to have installed so much wind power onshore that you have, despite the challenges that we hear about now also. And definitely in DNVGL, we recently launched our Energy Transition Outlook report, where it's stated that we need a lot more renewable energy if we want to meet the climate targets. And I think that's not a very new news. And therefore, I think onshore wind is equally important as offshore wind or solar. And definitely also, I cannot see why it should be a competition between them, but more a combination of those. One thing is that when you have a threat that makes us set targets for renewable energy, that's what we need. And then you can say, what are then the incentives to drive this actually happening? And I also heard a little bit about regulation mentioned from a few people. And seen from my point of view, especially in onshore wind here in India, I think there's a potential for more local supply chain. I think India has a huge knowledge and experience in technology. And it's also surprising to me that a lot of the components are actually coming from outside of India. So this is where I see a potential for future work locally in India. And maybe, as mentioned before also, this needs some kind of incentive from government level to happen. So of course it's also a political indication how to level, you can say, the playing ground or the playing field for the renewable energy. You can of course have, you can say, competition as we see it now when we transition into auctions. That, as I have seen in other countries also, it always drive technical risks because you want to have the project so the price will go down, and that means you have to optimize your technical parts much better. And I think actually competition is not only bad, I definitely think it also drives innovation, because when you have to deliver at a lower price and you want to win a project, you need to find a solution that nobody else has. So even if it's lower price, it still drives innovation from my point of view. But I definitely, from a, I can say, certification point of view also, of course, think and believe that having transparency in regulations and having, as I say, a level playing ground for investors and everyone in this industry is important. Otherwise, we will not get the investments, I think. But very specifically, I think I would say local supply chain is something that should have a chance in India, definitely.
Okay, thank you. And last but certainly by no means the least, Steve, thank you for being so patient. You know, you've traveled to India many times. You've seen the wind industry in India evolve over the last many years, dare I say even decades. You've seen the global wind industry as well. What are the unique characteristics about India that you think differentiate us from other parts of the world? And also a word about wind itself. So over to you.
Thanks, Sumant. And there's a lot to feed off of. And is this not?
It's louder.
Okay, I'll take the heavy one. On this wind versus solar thing, I really don't want to get into it other than to say that we need both. In most geographies, they're quite complementary. We are in direct competition in a few places now, but I would say that's rather a failing of the markets and planning than it is of some inherent advantage or disadvantage to the technologies. And the one thing that's really changed in the last 3-4 years is all of the major scenarios, including the one that DNV just launched, show us in 2050 with an energy system, not just a power system, but an energy system which is dominated by wind and PV. Some say a little more wind, some say a little more PV, some say a little more PV, but wind generates more electricity. I think the prices are now to the point where for the medium and longer term future, that's not really the issue. The issue is how you make the system work when it's dominated by variable renewables resources. And an awful lot of work has been done on that, and it needs to be. But the competition is really counterproductive in one sense, although of course it helps drive down the prices when that has been the main thing, I think, that has driven down the prices over the last 4 or 5 years. It's with necessity being the mother of invention. If you need to compete at a lower price, you'll come up with the technology to do it. It's not that just some technologist sits around and say, oh, how can I lower the price today? It's when his manager tells him, damn it, we need to get the prices down to meet this bid. And that's just the reality. And on the technology, we do have a very, very long way to go. And one of those, in terms of, we've come a very long way, but we're having the first 10 megawatt turbine now announced by Vestas. GE has got their 12 megawatts on the drawing board, and it's going to keep going up and up, and it's going to require new materials. And we have new innovations in resource assessment, which is really the fundamental thing of integrating wind into the electricity grid in the medium term, is to be able to say that our wind fleet will generate X now, X 6 hours from now, 12, 24, 48, 72 hours out. And we've come a long way on that, but we need to go a lot further. And two of the interesting developments in that area, which I think are important, are the nacelle-mounted LIDARs, which actually, particularly in turbulent wind areas, which do anticipitory pitch and yaw changes with the wind coming half a kilometer out in front, because the yaw gear doesn't move very quickly. But A, you can reduce the wear and tear on the machine, and B, you get a higher yield. And the second thing is the use of Doppler radar, which has been pioneered by Dong. It's not Dong anymore, Orsted. When it was pioneered, it was Dong. But using Doppler radar to actually model the entire airflow through an entire wind farm to minimize the wake effects, both in terms of casting shadows over downwind turbines and also for the increasing turbulence, which will also reduce efficiency. So while we have come a long way with technology, there's a very long way to go, and we're going to see both much larger and smaller turbines extracting a much higher percentage of the energy out of the wind. But I think in terms of the sector, we've heard a lot of reasons, a lot of discussion about the sector here. What an extraordinary achievement, the first non-OECD country to have a major wind industry, fourth in the world in terms of cumulative, and if it weren't for China, would be the leading non-OECD country in the industry. But market pressures are such now, and especially with the lowering prices, that what we're looking at is one not unlikely set of events is in terms of turbine manufacturers. Globally, we could have 90-95% of the market being covered by five of them in the not too distant future. That's one way. The other pressure, of course, is to create local jobs and to create local supply chains and all the rest of it, which is good for the local economy. And ultimately, governments have to decide. Do they want the cheapest LCOE, or do they want a local industry? Sometimes you get both of those if you're really lucky. Usually not. Usually it's a bit of a trade-off between the two. Because if we as a wind industry are mandated with delivering the largest number of carbon-free electrons at the lowest possible price, we're going to do that with a global supply chain. And like the solar industry does in manufacturing everything in China or Vietnam, we would do increasingly the same. Now, obviously, there are restrictions on wind because of the size of the components, and you're never going to want to design a system where you're transporting 80-meter blades across oceans. That's just not going to work. But ultimately, governments will have an industrial policy, or they will let the market decide, or they will do a half-hearted mishmash of the two. Our recommendation was they do one or the other. Either just let the market decide or have a clear industrial policy, which everyone understands, to develop a local industry. And I hoped that, and I still hope and I believe, that Make in India was going to be a part of that, which should help bolster the local supply chain here in India. And as we move into offshore, that's going to be even more necessary if we're going to have a competitive and sustainable offshore industry. Then very large parts of the supply chain are going to need to be localized. The bit about why companies pay a higher electricity bill only in India, it's in all of the non-OECD countries almost, that industry pays a higher price for electricity than consumers. Whereas in the OECD, it's always 180 degrees the opposite. Consumers pay a higher price and industry pays a much lower price, which they say, of course, is necessary to be competitive. Meanwhile, they're being outcompeted by all the companies in the non-OECD countries who are paying the higher electricity prices. It doesn't make any sense from anybody's perspective, and I don't know how they get away with it. But rationalization of energy prices across the board is going to have to take place. I could say a lot more about innovation. I won't, but I will say one thing about where we need to go as we get ready for the release at the end of this week of the IPCC's report on the technological implications of meeting either of the Paris targets, the 1.5 or the 2 degrees C target, and with the negotiations coming up in Poland at the end of the year. The one thing that's absolutely clear from any scenario is that we're going to have any chance of meeting either of the Paris targets. We'll need a carbon-free power sector well before 2050. So think about that when you buy your new coal plant or your gas plant. Either it has an economic lifetime of less than 25 or 30 years, or 25 years, because by the time you build it, it'll only be 25 years left. Or you're investing in a stranded asset, or the tooth fairy is going to save us from climate change. I don't believe in the tooth fairy, so I think we kind of need to do it ourselves. And I'll sort of leave it there. Except for the integration issue, if you ask the Danes, ask Uruguay, ask Norway, ask Brazil, ask lots of people who are at well over 50% renewable energy supply, how they manage to integrate them, or Portugal, or Spain, or Ireland. My favorite comment is from the State Secretary of Energy of Portugal about 6 or 7 years ago. And he said, yeah, we had a weekend the other week when we were getting 95% of our electricity from wind. And what happened? Absolutely nothing. We planned for it. It's a system management tool. That's not a problem. And we can do it. So don't underestimate the cleverness of humans and system operators if you give them a hand to actually operate the system, to optimize it for everyone. Thanks very much.
Great, thank you. Thank you all for being so patient. We've gone through all the 10 speakers here. It's taken us a bit of time, but we finally got it done. So let's throw it open to the house. Any questions? Please, when you ask your questions, identify yourselves, which company you're from, your name, of course, and who are you directing the question to? Any questions, please raise your hands. There's one gentleman at the back who I guess is going to kick things off.
Hi, my name is Siddharth and I'm from MEC. Nobody has touched here upon corporate PPAs, and we know that they have become quite big all over the world. So what is, you know, your views on corporate PPAs in India, and what will it take to take off that market? And that is for the IPPs and for the government as well.
Sunil, Vipul, any of you guys want to answer that?
Yeah. Well, corporate PPAs are happening in India across the country. But if you ask me how they're going to really take off, you need a long-term stable policy. The problem in corporate PPAs is that the utilities whose customers use steel, so-called in their terms, resist their high-paying customers going out. You know, unfortunately, you cannot blame the DISCOMs because they are subsidizing the poor, and therefore they need to get a revenue from somewhere else. And what we do with corporate PPAs, we take away those high-paying customers. But well, that cannot be a logic for denying open access and denying your supply of green power to corporates. There is a deeper problem which needs to be corrected. And probably if you look at the new draft regulations in the Electricity Act amendment, where the government is talking of direct benefit transfer to the poor in terms of the cost of the subsidy, I think that should partially solve this problem. It would also need an amendment to the Electricity Act where you cannot be denied open access on any pretext. Corporates are signing pledges for being 100% green, and therefore they need to be given a flexibility to buy power from whomever they want and from wherever they want. So it's still a distance away, and power being a concurrent subject in our country, it has its own challenges. I don't see that happening in the near future immediately, but I think so. It has started, and I believe that corporate PPAs could become a norm in 2 to 3 years' time if we get these amendments right in our Electricity Act.
There's an interesting development in China around PPAs. Most of you will know that China has gone from a very much an undercapacity market to an overcapacity market. And in the absence, because they have so much state-owned power generation, they don't have effectively a competitive market in the way that we see a market working. So they don't have a merit scheme. So what they've encouraged foreign investors like CLP to do is to enter into PPA agreements, or they call it direct sales, with individual users of power. So your big steel mills or your aluminium smelting. So big users of power. Now, this has some merits in that it allows you to get a better utilization of your plant. But invariably, when you go into a PPA, it's less than the wholesale price that you get if you were feeding the grid. And so you've got to be very careful about the proportion and how this whole PPA is managed across the whole spectrum of the, because it can corrupt the energy offtake going forward.
I think Sunil and Derek have covered it quite nicely. Just on a lighter note, I'd like to say this is a case where Mia and Bivi are quite razi, but in this case, the Qazi also needs to be razi. There's more than enough demand from the corporates, there are more than enough IPPs ready to supply, but that transition that the DISCOMs are going through has to be managed. From an IPP's perspective, I can say it probably needs to be accelerated, but let's see where we go.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, hi, I'm Aditya from Global Infrastructure Partners. I think you rightly said, Sumant, it's a galaxy of stars, so I'm really happy to get all the thoughts from the sector players. The incremental thing that I would really appreciate getting some thoughts on is the increased competitive intensity that we have seen over the last 12, 18 months in the sector. Now, of course, a lot of it can be attributed, as some of the people mentioned, to the technological advancements. But do you think, is there some kind of irrational exuberance building up in the sector? Is the sector going to be a victim of its own success? Lately, people have started drawing comparisons with, you know, what happened in thermal space in 2007-08 and then in roads in 2011-12. So, you know, some comments on that would be helpful.
So when you say sector, you mean renewable sector? Or
actually,
you just mean
renewables. No, this is not specific to winds. It's okay. Actually, you know, generic.
Okay.
Across.
No, no. Malcolm doesn't want to answer this question.
That's what I said. Somebody else can moderate. Sumant, you must answer this.
Okay, look, I'll answer the question. So is there too much competition? I won't say that there is too much competition. Ultimately, we have a lot of megawatts to get executed in the country. The government has a very active target. And I think the more players that come in, I think the better it is for the sector as a whole. Now, I would say that by and large in the wind sector, you know, as the number of good sites go away, as the transmission infrastructure gets exhausted, I think you will see some change in tariffs happening. I think you'll also see the same happening in the solar sector. In solar, there are a few other risks as well. And I think because different people take different views on some of those risks, therefore the range of outcomes on the solar side is a little bit wider than it is on the wind side. So I think it's really for that reason that you're seeing a little bit more of dispersion happening in solar perhaps compared to wind. But I think in general, I think we should be fairly happy with where things are right now. The sector, you know, there are a lot of decent players, good quality players, certainly in the wind side. I won't speak so much for solar since this is not a solar session. And I think the government is getting good tariffs. OEMs are not getting returns, is what Ramesh is saying. And perhaps Mr. Chalsani would agree with him. And I would too, most likely. IPPs are sort of at the margin right now, not really making great returns either. But it's sort of okay to survive. So I think that's really where we are. It's not a great scenario, but it's also not such a bad scenario. So I would say it's right where the government wants it to be at this point in time.
Could I? This is working. Okay. I just want to add something quick. Is that, yes, prices are going down, but what's going to happen when you suddenly have a lot of electric cars come on the market? You're going to have a sudden big need for all that extra energy. So I'm not sure it's a rational exuberance. We're going to find a use for it.
Would you like to say anything, Mr. Yadav?
You know, I don't think so. Exuberances would be the word, but probably there would be challenges because the macroeconomic factors are changing off late in the last couple of months. So what people have done, what people have bid, or what people are building, that's all fine. You know, earlier people say you got lower returns purely because tariff makes headlines. The fact is that nobody talks of the reduction in costs. An investor would take a spread on his return from the cost of the capital which he raises from the market. So if my debt cost is, say, 9% and I need a 6% spread over the debt because there is a 3% country risk and 3% is my project and other risk I need to make. Now, if the cost of the debt goes up to 10%, that 6% will stay where it is. So then your return goes higher and so does the tariff. So that is where the difference is. I don't think so. The investors are getting exuberant over the whole thing. We are trying to stay where we are. A half a percent or a percent here or there, depending on the quality of the counterparty, because then the spread goes down. So if there is a spread of 5%, NTPC comes in, I may do it at 4%. So that makes a difference. So all the projects which have been built at 2.44 and you made headline tariffs and saying they are not viable have all been built and delivering energy. So we don't have to be so much concerned about the tariffs. Let's be more concerned about the quality of the projects and their delivery.
Mr. Yadav, would you like to add?
Excuse me. I think we've seen number of, you know, bids. So that would, to a large extent, answer your apprehensions about irrational exuberance. And if we see the inputs or the participants in different bids, these were different. I've seen a number of participants getting added to each new bid, and a large number of them were of international origins. So, and they were, I'll say, fairly stable tariff structures. These could be subjected to even mathematical analysis. I'll say fairly, stable calculations. I don't see much of irrationality here. The way tariffs are going up, they have their own reasons, as has been explained partially by Mr. Sumant Sinha, that the sites are getting exhausted, and there are other. Basically, when a bidder participates, the risks, the perceived risks, and if you go deeply into the outcome of tariffs between different states, I think the perceived risks become more pronounced. Let's say if you compare tariffs of Tamil Nadu, or if you compare the tariffs of Maharashtra or Gujarat, so you'll see these were all rational, and the first SECI bids have already, SECI projects, the SECI 1 projects have already started getting executed. I would invite you to be part of the valedictory session, wherein one of the projects, 250 megawatt, will be getting remotely inaugurated. So I don't see much cause of concern on the irrational exuberance part.
Mr. Yadav, if I can just do a follow-on comment. I think what I was alluding to is, it's kind of counterintuitive that you see tariffs falling in the face of interest rates rising, rupee depreciation, threat of safeguard duty coming in. It's just kind of somewhere the maths doesn't kind of... So you talked about looking in deeper into the economics of these projects, but if one were to actually kind of drill down, somewhere the system kind of doesn't really add up. So maybe that's, each to his own in terms of what bidders are looking at. But what I was trying to understand more was in terms of sustainability. I totally agree with you, all these projects have been built and will continue to be built. But as Vipul mentioned, I think one thing that investors typically look at is the sustainability over if one is investing for 15, 20, 25 years. So just project getting commissioned is one thing and the cash flow sustainability is another. So whether the sector would see some kind of upheaval in the next few years was actually the question. Maybe consolidation is the answer, I don't know.
I think I will just quickly comment before I give it back. because this risk is, of course, for DNVGL as also being a certification body or a third party in many projects, it's also our concern to make sure we are not just having things built, but for investors, it's equally important that you have sustainability and reliability so that you actually get your finances back over a period of time. And the lower the cost is, or the lower the bidding price is, the longer return of investment probably also is. I'm not a financier, so I will not go into that. But I think there is a point in saying that technical risk and technical risk assessment should be part of the projects to make sure you get reliable projects built in the end. And that is, of course, also a little bit back to regulatory requirements. And personally, even though I'm working with certification, I'm not fond of having too rigid regulations, but at least have, you can say, transparent and reliable and you can say enough regulation that actually can control this for all the parties involved. It's not just for one party, it's for everybody, because it's also for the people who construct this. If everybody wants to build a sustainable project, I'm quite sure.
Thank you.
You want me to cut?
I think when the environment is changed, some sort of structural readjustment will take place when the competitive environment is set in. So there will be some pains, you know. So there will be some structural, you know, readjustment. The entities which are not efficient will either have to improve or will be bought by the larger efficient entities. I'm sure you can give those examples. Further, I see a number of examples where the PLFs or the wind turbines are being demonstrated at much higher PLF. We spoke about comparison between wind and solar. These are going at much higher rate, you know. In solar, we are barely rising above 20-21. Here, we are like straightway jumping from 30 to 40. I'm sure most of the OEMs will give their examples, you know, that the coming up with bigger or better turbines at materials which are lighter and the cost which are, you know, comparable, if not more. So these structural changes do take place, but these changes are for better, if I can understand from the broadest perspective. So I think that's it.
Mr. Dingham, you have a question.
Well, I don't have a question, but I have a comment. After some serious discussion, I have a comment. Well, I think most of them had come to attend this session thinking that it's a dedicated session for wind alone. But most of the discussion, I think, centered around comparison of wind and solar. That was really interesting. That's what is my comment.
Okay, let's just take one last question from the gentleman at the back. And then we should wrap it up because we're already at 6 o'clock.
Thank you. My question is to Mr. Yadav. I am Rakesh Rathor from Sembcorp. So, Mr. Yadav, as you put forward the issue upfront regarding the gestation period of transmission system and gestation period of renewable projects, so we do see a real gap here because the issue was prolonged earlier as well. Government did a good job earlier with regards to green corridors and all. We can see that government is pushing very hard on evaluating where they need to put more corridors. My quick issue is rather the extension of Mr. Vipul saying the period which requires in allocating these projects, just like standing committee, then national committee, then import committee, then whether it go to under TBCB or which route, whatever route. But that whole process take a huge time, and we don't really see that you have the luxury of time to decide after like 6 or 9 months later that the project will be executed when, and then you start working. So probably your bids are also not aligned with the time frame, 18 month or 20
month. And the question, if I may just interject, is that the evacuation infrastructure approvals, can they be speeded up? Because it takes 6 months and that leads into the actual execution timeline.
In short, I don't hold forth for the transmission infrastructure and I don't understand much of it. Nevertheless, this issue of non-availability or delayed availability of transmission infrastructure is being deliberated, and several levels of decisions have already been taken. I think we are committing about 30,000 crores, about 10 for for wind places. We did this exercise both for solar and wind. We asked all of you where would you like to set up your next plant or next levels of plants, where in India, and both for solar. So the places were identified, and the cost and other things were added, and I think fairly regarding shorting of the time frame, I frankly it'll not be fair for me to answer because I do not know.
Okay, thank you all. Let me just very, very quickly sum up the conversation that we just had right now. So I think, first of all, to take on from the point that Vipul was making earlier, we should all, in some senses, assuming that all of you are from the wind industry, give ourselves a little bit of pat on the back for having got the industry to this point, right? So 35,000 megawatts and another 7,000 that has been allocated. So that's, I think, one piece of good news. I think, having said that, there are concerns around issues like curtailment that does eat into returns, the off-taker quality, that also has an impact. So I think those are issues that we have to watch out for. OEMs have an issue about the fact that it's not just technology, but it's also a development of the entire supply chain, which requires some degree of volume commitment on the part of the government to become a little bit more clearer, and that hopefully allows tariffs or costs to come down even further. So I think there is, from all the discussions that we've had, I think a general sense of belief that costs in wind hopefully can come down even more as we go forward. Of course, that has to be offset against the availability of good sites, availability of evacuation infrastructure. But as we heard from Mr. Yadav, there is going to be a lot of investment on the infrastructure, evacuation infrastructure side. So that hopefully will again open up new areas for us to get into. Wind tariffs, wind PLFs are already fairly high, and I think we have to look at wind PLFs in conjunction with solar, and the two are really complementary, not really exclusionary from each other, and that's the way we have to think about it. And we also have to look, as Mr. Chalsani said, at how to in fact improve the quality of the grid so that it can take up more and more capacity of renewable energy going forward, which will of course then be important and relevant for having a much deeper penetration of wind into the grid. So I think all in all, a sense of optimism with a degree of caution, and I think a good work plan for all of us to work on in the years to come. Thank you all. Thank you.
I will request panelists to wait for a few more minutes. We have some gifts which Mr. Yadav will